Thank you. Thanks for being here, everyone. Really exciting day for us as we welcome Alyssa to Minneapolis. It was 1 week ago and in a few hours that Alyssa was hearing her name called by the Minnesota Lynx on national television, and I'll let her talk about that experience. But we're excited to have Alyssa. We're going to learn a lot about her in the coming weeks, but more than anything, what we appreciated about her in the process was we were just talking about this, the consistency in her game, emotional maturity that she has, never too high, never too low. Skill set wise, we've talked a lot about this. We really wanted to expand upon our three-point shooting. That was an add for us as we went into the offseason, and to have that in the post position is really, really valuable. That's not all Alyssa is. She's really, really difficult to match up with in the post. So the ability to do both and what you choose to guard her with. We saw the national TV game where if they want to put a 6'8 center on her, she's going to take it to three-point line and drop 37 on you if you go out there and try to guard her. And then if you say, okay, we need a mobile player on her, well, then Alyssa's going to take them into the post and abuse them down there. So really excited about her skill set. You notice I haven't talked about defense yet. That is a part of her game that we're going to grow exponentially as she becomes a professional. Her college coach told me it wasn't necessarily Alyssa's fault. You know, the coach felt like, you know, maybe being on the floor a little longer was a good idea, so not to be in foul trouble. And that was, you know, I mean, that was sort of the response, and I said, we'll have to change that very, very quickly because you won't have to worry about, you know, being on the court for 30 minutes in a row. Like a lot of times they do with college. So excited to have Alyssa, and you know, welcome questions for Alyssa or I.
Who would like to start us off? Will in the back.
Alyssa, the welcome ceremony earlier today at the Target Center, what did that mean to you?
It meant a lot. Like I said in my speech over there, I think just having people around you who really care about just what's important to you, and they kind of show that on display, just welcoming me with, you know, things from my background and my culture, and then just getting to meet everybody, it was a super cool experience.
Jana?
Jana, I work with Will at the NBC station here in town. Welcome to Minnesota. We're happy to have you.
Thank you.
What, you're coming off of a basketball season a lot of us dreamed of, worked toward for their whole lives, and you got to be a part of it. Now you're in a bar in Minneapolis that didn't exist a year ago, and you're not going to be able to get, well, you're going to be able to get in, but most of us are not ever again because the line goes around the corner. To watch people like you play, what does it mean to be a player at this moment in women's basketball?
It means a lot, and I think especially because when I first started college, the game wasn't like this at all. And so to really just see the perspective from that to now, it's amazing to see the growth and just, you know, everything that women have been fighting for in our sport, just to finally get the recognition. And, you know, we deserve it, so I'm just happy that that's turned around.
Marty? Hi, Marty Rubin with Beyond Women's Sports. What I'm curious about is what, in assessing yourself, what is it about you, not as Alyssa the athlete, but as Alyssa the person, the human being, that makes you a good teammate?
I think I was raised to, you know, just be a very genuine and caring person. The people that I was surrounded by my whole life, really just supported me and really lifted me up to even be here right now. And I think when you're surrounded by people like that, you get, like, your morals and your values are just, you know, very in line. And I think that's just what I bring to a team, is just being a good person and somebody that's just dependable and works hard and, you know, is very respectful. So, yeah.
Kent?
Yeah, talking defense, we're going to grow a defense exponentially. You know, we're going to more defense. We don't worry about that she needs to play defense. I think perhaps, you know, given, you know, especially after the injury to Gianna last year, you had to be on the court all the time. I mean, what do you think your ceiling is as far as defending in this league?
I think you know, I'm a competitor, so, and I'm also somebody who is very honest with myself. You know, if I'm lacking in an area, I will acknowledge it and, you know, not shy away from that or deny it. And so, you know, like, when I talked to Coach, it was something that we discussed, and it's something that I even discussed with my college coach. And so I think it's just, it's something that I know, you know, has been a question mark for me, just really in general from people just criticizing my game or whatever. But, you know, it's just the competitor in me just wants to, you know, kind of prove people wrong and just, you know, become a better overall player, and that starts on being better on the defensive end too.
Jeffrey?
This one's for Cheryl. When we were at the exit interviews at the end of last season, I know I asked you a question about the scouting process for this year's draft and whether you had candidates in mind, and you pretty much said we're looking at a few. Now that the draft has been held and here we are, I just want to know, how long have you been scouting Melissa, and when did you know that she was your target?
I've been, I watched Melissa as a freshman, and so what year were you a freshman at USC?
That was 2019, 2020.
So 2019, 2020 was a freshman, so that was our first time seeing Melissa, and you could see that she was a special talent, and then just following players as they moved through college. The move to Utah was one that put her a little more on our radar because I have an appreciation for the way that Utah plays, the way that their coach coaches, and the system of pick and roll, that, you know, a little more pro ready. And so we, you know, just, we enjoyed their success. And then, you know, I think in terms of a target, I don't know if Alyssa knows that we were there a few times watching Alyssa, watched her practice, watched shoot around, hung out in her coach's office. Claire was out there, so I don't know how much players know with these sorts of things, but I don't think you really know because of where we were drafting. We knew it at 7 when we held the 7th pick. We had a really strong idea of what was happening ahead of us, and so we felt like we also, in moving to 8, still understood, you know, who was going to be there. And so I'd say once we made that move, I think that sort of solidified that Alyssa was our target. And, you know, we felt good about that. You know, I had conversations with her coach that I don't think her coach shared with Alyssa, even as the draft was moving, because we're ahead of the draft. And so, you know, being able to, I asked her if she wanted to be surprised or would she like to know. Not Alyssa. Alyssa was, I think, surprised, but her coach was not interested in suspense. So we did share, but I think her coach was excited because I think we, you know, we have some synergy about the way we see the game, and I think in just the way that she coaches Alyssa, and, you know, things that I enjoy and things that I know she's going to be ready for when she hears as a pro.
Yeah, Alyssa, I'm just wondering how you think your game developed and improved.
I think that I kind of just needed to be somewhere that, you know, I was in the right mind frame, and I think that was the biggest part for me. But something that really was a game changer was just getting in better shape, and actually being able to, you know, do what I could do without, you know, kind of just being held back from fatigueness. And so, yeah, I think that was the biggest thing, but also, you know, I kept working on my post game, and got my touches around the rim. I think that my finishes were something that were very good while I was at Utah, just because, you know, like field goal percentage and things like that was pretty high while I was there. And then definitely three point shots. I think I was shooting the best I've ever shot.
What do you know about the kind of the history of this program? Did you watch this team when you were younger win titles?
You could be honest.
Yeah, to be honest, I don't know much. I didn't really grow up watching any pro sports. You know, I have a bunch of siblings, so I'm always at their games and supporting them and watching them. So, yeah, to answer your question, no.
Terry?
Hi, Lisa. Terry Horseman of the Knicks. Welcome to Minnesota. I know the last week has probably been a pretty big whirlwind for you, but in that time, have you had the chance to connect with any of your new teammates and just sort of foresee how you'll fit into the group that's already here?
Today was the first time I met them, and it is a very quick turnaround, so, you know, I'll have some time before training camp to kind of get to know them and work out with them, but Ruthie Hebert is somebody that I knew previously because we're both from Alaska, and, you know, we're both playing in the state tournament. She was a senior when I was a freshman, and then we also played each other in the Pac-12, so she's somebody I'm familiar with, but everybody else, I'm just looking forward to getting to know them.
And you mentioned how your three-point shooting sort of really exploded at Utah. I think it almost doubled in the 40% range. Is that something that just came out with the way Lynn Roberts coaches? Sort of coincidental, just, you know, how do you, you know, explain that elevation in your three-point game?
Yeah, I think that's a part of it, is just the style of play that Utah, the program, does. You know, everybody's shooters, so, you know, you got to be, I mean, you don't have to be, but it's very helpful to be a three-point threat on that team. So, but also I think it just came from confidence. My confidence really grew, and that's kind of what, you know, I've always been able to shoot, but, you know, the confidence part was the part that, you know, really kind of elevated my shooting game.
Lucas?
Alyssa, Lucas Siapa with the Knicks. You had mentioned earlier kind of the importance of your culture. And many people maybe don't necessarily know, but Minnesota is a pretty rich diversity, cultural melting pot, with Somali culture, Native American culture, that kind of stuff. Can you just basically tell us what your culture means to you?
Yeah, it means everything to me. And, you know, just because I was, the way I was raised, you know, I have older relatives who kind of try to keep the, like, traditions and everything alive, and, you know, a big part of my life was, you know, doing those traditions, and, you know, it's something that kind of stuck with me and stuff that I love to do. And it's just, like, a time where, you know, like, our family really kind of gets to bond and be with each other, and that's a big part of, like, who I am. I'm a big family person. And, you know, I was just surrounded by it my whole life, so to kind of be at this big stage and represent my people, just because, you know, like, a lot of people know that it's the representation for, you know, indigenous people and Polynesians in sports. You know, it may be big in football, but, you know, women's basketball, it's pretty unheard of, so it's just special to me to kind of be able to represent my people on this stage.
Yeah, Alyssa, Pat Worsey with MinPost.com. Again, just to follow up, can you give me an example of one or two of those traditions that your family was able to keep alive?
Yeah, so we have Sunday dinner, or Sunday lunch, I would say, after church. We would all gather, and, you know, even like holidays, everybody would just, it's just one. Whoever has the biggest house, that's the house we're going to. But, you know, it's just things like that, just getting the family together. You know, I don't, this is not really a traditional one, but we would go camping every Memorial Day weekend. Like, that was our first camping trip every weekend, and that was really fun. But today at the arena, I was brought up there to dance, and that's something else that's just representing of my culture and a tradition that we do at, you know, weddings and graduations, things like that, that is a part of our culture traditions.
When you have that big family lunch, what's generally served?
Oh, a lot of different things. You know, there's some Samoan, like, dishes that all of you are probably not familiar with. I would say it's a lot of rice, it's a lot of meat, and yeah, it's really good food, but there's a big variety.
Any last questions in person?
Just wondering if your two teammates from Minnesota here have given you a primer at all of what you're walking into here.
Gianna, my teammate, is from Duluth, so she's not from, you know, the city. But they told me it's cold But, you know, I come from Alaska and then I went to Utah, so that don't bother me.
We'll now pivot to Zoom. We'll start off.
I think there was one more in the back.
Okay.
Cheryl, for you, when it comes to Alyssa's offensive skill set, what are you most excited about?
I think putting the ball in the hole at a very efficient rate is something that I think most coaches find valuable. So not just a shot taker, but an efficient way that she conducts her business on the court. So I think if you look at us last year, really both sides, you know, both offense and defense, we could use some real improvement. And scoring the basketball was certainly one of them. You know, it's hard to know whether our defense wasn't as good because our offense wasn't, you know, too far above average, or vice versa. If we play a little better defense, maybe offense comes easier. But while we're here, we'll let Alyssa know that defense turns into offense. We'll say that side of the ball starts first, but certainly Alyssa can score the basketball.
Grace Stockton, I'm curious. You've moved around different states, different teams. What anchors you, or what, through these periods of change?
My family, I think. You know, no matter where I go, I'm always calling them on FaceTime and everything. So, you know, they just... Oh, I have, I'll be forgetting sometimes. There's nine of us, nine siblings. Yeah, the youngest is 3 years old and the oldest is 25. So it's a big age range. But I mean, they're everything to me. And you know, when I get all these awards and I get drafted and stuff, you know, I call them and they humble me real quick. So, you know, just to have that support, you know, that tough love, it really grounds me. And it just always reminds me to just stay true to who I am and just to not change no matter where I go, no matter what environment I'm in. And so, yeah, I would say that's what grounds me.
Thank you. Any further questions in person? Can now pivot to the Zoom. We'll start off with you, Megan.
Yeah, hey, Alyssa, this is Megan Hall with USA Today's For the Win. Got to see you at the draft, so good to see you again here. But wanted to ask you, one of the really cool moments from this weekend was seeing you guys interact the draft class. I wanted to ask, was there anyone that you got to spend time with that you didn't get to before?
Yeah, I think both of the UConn girls, Aaliyah and Nika, we sat at the same table at dinner, and it was really fun getting to know them and talk to them a little bit, because, you know, like, when I first came and saw all these girls, I'm like, I've seen all of you on TV, but, like, to see everybody in person in the same room was kind of crazy, and it was different. So, yeah, I would say those two were two of the players that I really kind of was conversating with and got to know better.
Brad?
Yes, hi, Melissa. It's Bradley from WNBA Swish. Can you speak to what it's going to be like to be mentored by the likes of Lisa and others on the team, and what you feel you're going to be able to learn from them?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm coming into a team with very talented players, and something I was most excited about coming to the league was just learning, because, you know, when you're in college, you know you're a good player, but I think it's a different thing to just come to a different league and just know that, you know, your potential could be so much higher and there's so much more to know and learn about the game. And, you know, I'm very looking forward to just, you know, getting to know my teammates and just being mentored by them. And I think that it's going to be a super good experience just to, you know, be on the floor with other great people.
Josh?
Hey, this is Josh here from Eagles Daily News. Haven't seen you since the shootout, but since again, congratulations. What was it like sharing that whole pre-draft experience and drafting experience with your family? I know your dad was real emotional.
Yeah, my dad, he acts tough, but he's a very emotional guy, you know. But, my parents were there, most of my siblings, my boyfriend, and it was just so amazing to have, you know, the people who helped you get to that spot be there And that was something that was super important to me. And, you know, like when I look at my parents after my name was called, I could just see how proud they were in their faces. And, you know, it made me cry. It makes me emotional because that's really like my goal in life is just to make them proud. You know, they've given so much up for me. And, you know, just where we come from, it's my parents didn't come from a lot. So to kind of just them see their hard work and everything pay off, to see their kids make it to the highest level, I think that's what means the most to me.
Cheryl on the Zoom.
Hi, question is for Coach. You talked about your appreciation for the way Utah plays and Alyssa's style, but what are some of the characteristics of programs and college coaches as a whole that you look for when targeting players, especially programs like Utah that have seen an amazing turnaround in a few years, kind of like what you experienced early on with the Lynx?
Yeah, and I watched Utah prior to Alyssa's arrival, and you could see they were an up-and-coming program, probably much like Alyssa saw when she considered transferring there. What I saw, I think what stands out often is a style of play that kind of draws you in. And so I think programs that have an identity, and you walk out of the gym and you know what it is that they're about. And then when you get on the inside and you watch practice and you watch accountability, a level of accountability to what they're doing, coaching the details. And when Alyssa goes to set a screen, if she misses the screen, you know, the angle wasn't great. You know, that's sort of our love language. That when you, you know, that's not going to be the first time Alyssa hears it when we're talking about the details. And so culture, I think, is huge. I want players that believe in culture, that participate in the culture. I want players that want to be a part of the process and not just experience outcomes. And so I think, in general, those are programs that we, you know, we say that players could be more pro ready, and specifically Minnesota Lynx ready.
Travis.
Hi. Yes. This is a question for Alyssa. I just want to know what part of your game do you think will translate over to the WNBA easy, and what's something you really need to work on? When you get
into
training camp and everything, so you can be the best version of yourself for the Lynx?
Well, I know what I'm good at, and, you know, I think even being good at those things will make the transition easy, but I think the things that I'm good at are, you know, just scoring efficiently, my touch around the rim, being physical, and just three-point shooting. And then something that I need to do better, just improve, is just getting in shape, and really defense, like Coach said. So I think that once I do those two things, and then, you know, keep working on shooting and like sharpening up what I'm good at still, I think that's what it will take to make me the best overall player.
Thank you.
Ryan?
Let's say you talk about, you know, maybe not watching the Lynx growing up or professional sports, but coming to a storied franchise with championship pedigree like the Lynx, what does it mean to you to be able to join a, you know, organization like that?
It means a lot. I think, you know, somewhere that has a rich basketball history is honestly just an honor to be a part of and to kind of carry that forward. And so, yeah, I'm just excited to kind of help to add to that, just winning culture.
And then a follow-up to that, you know, is there a player that you kind of wanted to model your game after growing up in college?
No, like, I didn't really watch pros growing up. So, you know, what I did was I just was in our little cul-de-sac on our street playing basketball with my dad and my brothers. We went to this gym in Alaska called the Alaska Club, and we would go there and just run pickup. And so that's really how I just picked up my skills and everything that I do on the court, being physical and things like that. So, and then once I started taking basketball more seriously, I kind of started to, you know, work on different things and different skills, not only just things I was doing in street ball. So Yeah, I think I didn't really watch anybody or try to mold my game. I think that just the way I play is very unique, and it's very, I feel like, straightforward. So, yeah.
Any final questions?
For Coach, if I could. Coach, did Alyssa kind of remind you of any player that you coached or seen in the past when you took her?
Yeah, I would say that a lot of times we do comps for players, and there was a player a few years back, Danielle Adams, that played at Texas A&M, that had the three-point shooting, undersized post player, that, you know, Alyssa's listed at 6'2", but Fee is not even 6'1", and she's taller than Alyssa. So, you know, we can keep calling her 6'2", that's great, right?
No, you guys can change it.
She doesn't like it, so she's 5'11", right? But undersized, and so a unique, and Danielle Adams is such a great comp, because Danielle, if you switch, that's what your instinct is to do when you're playing a shooter, a shooting big, is your instinct is to switch. And when you switch, and now Alyssa can go into the post, well, Danielle Adams was exceptional at that. And that's, you know, that's probably, you know, a starting point in terms of skill set. And I think that, you know, some of the things that Alyssa mentioned, I think the exciting thing for a young player like Alyssa that has so much ahead of her in the way of basketball, that I think, yeah, tasting success, experiencing success. I told her she's coming to our franchise at a good time, in that, you know, 5 years ago we weren't playing rookies very much at all, and you didn't want to be drafted by the Lynx because you weren't going to play because we had legends in front of you. This is a really good time to be a young player, because we're in our phase of winning while developing, and having a sustainable success, a path for players that will be with us for a long time. So she's going to get a chance to be on the court and taste success and have those moments where it's a little bit like golf. When you hit a good shot, it keeps bringing you back. Well, it's the same concept. You know, each day Alyssa's going to have these successes that she's going to have a thirst for wanting more and continuing to grow. The resources in our league are at an all-time high for players, in that her support goes well beyond just getting to the gym shooting. You know, we have capital investments in our shooting aid that's all throughout the gym. First of all, our facility is second to none. And so just having things at her fingertips, our sports performance coach that Alyssa will spend time with, and she'll be strength training and conditioning, as she mentioned, player development coach. So there's so much at a young player's disposal that it's a really exciting time. You know, I think Alyssa's game, you know, will, as a starting point, we always talk about a floor. I want a player whose floor, that every day she comes in, is going to be able to exist in our league with shooting and finishing at the rim, rebounding, that sort of thing. If she comes in every day and does those things, she can find success and will help our team, and then grow from there and head towards what her ceiling may be.
And then we'll wrap with one final question from Brad.
Yes. Hi, Coach. Can you speak to how players like Essa and other rookies are going to help you build a foundation for the future and to meet your organization goals?
Yeah, we're excited about that, as I just alluded to, that last season, I think that was one of the more exciting narratives that come from the season, is we were very committed to playing Diamond Miller, our number two pick. But then even further than that, we were really excited about how the draft turned out for us. And we got a French player that we'll be seeing at a later time. But Dorca Juhas, who was the 16th pick, we ended up starting two rookies and had some success in doing that. So they're going to continue to grow. And then you add, you know, someone like Alyssa to the group, and you just kind of go, again, you can train on the job, so to speak, and build towards a sustainable future of success. And, you know, I think the one thing that will be obvious to Alyssa when she comes into our practices is that the expectations are very high. And if you hang around Minneapolis for a little while, you meet all the great Lynx fans, you'll understand they like championships. They like those banners that hang in Target Center. And, you know, we're on a mission to, you know, put ourselves in that space where we're competing for championships. And so that's what I see for this team. When you have a chance to have young talent, We've really turned our attention towards the draft rather than away from the draft, which we did at one time. We were all about veterans, and so I just think this is an exciting time, and a sustainable, successful future is what we want Alyssa to be a part of.
Josh, do you have one question?
You mentioned that you and Ruby played against each other, you know, at the high school level, and then at the collegiate level. What's it going to be like? It's only been six Alaskans that ever played at the WNBA. But what's it like for you guys to represent, you know, your home state on this day? How do you hope to get to play with her?
Yeah, it would be super cool, I think. You know, the only two Alaskans in the league we were talking about earlier.
We have them all.
Yep. The Lynx got them all. So it's just really cool, you know, especially just, you know, we played for the same AAU team. She was on the older team, but just coming from the same place, like, I feel like we know how hard it is to kind of, you know, make a way for yourself out of there. And, you know, just to be that, I don't know, pave the way for the rest of the, you know, young female basketball players over there. It's going to be super cool. And for them to see us playing on the same team, that'll be a really cool thing.
And then to wrap up today, we will also have Alyssa and Cheryl sign the wall with other greats in sports, including Katie Smith, Rebecca Lamar Brunson, and Diamond Miller.
Thank you.